Hello and welcome to Historify. Today I shall be talking to you about the Chauri Chaura incident, which took place almost 100 years ago on the 4th of February in the year 1922. This unforgettable event was largely forgotten in nationalistic lore, and it came to be remembered only as the episode which forced Mahatma Gandhi to call off his All India movement of non-cooperation against the British. Before we dwell into the details of this incident, it is necessary to understand the backdrop of the Indian National Movement and the fight for India for freedom from the British Empire. When we go back into the pages of history, we have to talk about how the British happened to come in India. And then we need to study about the establishment of the East India Company, which was incorporated by a royal charter on December 31, 1600, by the British Crown. The East India Company happened to be a monopolistic trading body. Under the leadership of Sir Thomas Roe, an embassy arrived in the court of the Mughal Emperor Jahangir, and after a lot of effort and a lot of persuasion, Sir Thomas Roe was able to gain an audience with Jahangir. Being a diplomat and a very capable and persuasive man, Sir Thomas Roe not only was able to gain an audience with the emperor, but he was also able to strike a deal with him that in coming times would change the fate of our country. He sought the permission and was able to gain also the permission to establish a factory at Surat. Now, this establishment of the British factory at Surat paved the way for a new destiny of India, which will happen with the passage of time due to the decline of the Mughal Empire. Now, after Aurangzeb, we know pretty well that the Mughal Empire started disintegrating and the dynasty started declining. And the British East India Company was able to gain momentum and also able to gain a stronger position with the passage of time on our soils. Then occurred the Battle of Plassey in the year 1757, which proved to be a decisive victory for the East India Company over a much larger force of the Nawab of Bengal, Siraj ud-Daulah. And this victory was won by the British under the leadership of Clive. Having sowed the seeds of nearly a two century of British rule in India, we reached the Battle of Buxar, which happened in the year 1764, which in turn turned out to be a nail in the coffin. And because this was highlighted by the defeat of the three most powerful allies of the Mughal Empire in India, Major Hector Munro defeated Mir Qasim, the Nawab of Bengal, Shuja ud-Daulah, the Nawab of Awadh, and Shah Alam, the Mughal Emperor himself. So this triple alliance got defeated in the face of the East India Company, which finally led to the establishment of the British power in India, which spread across India and paved the way for the plunder of our country, and the British became the virtual rulers of our country. They acquired leadership and they annexed a lot of territory. Gradually, they kept on moving and establishing their power across the country. There were the Anglo-Mysore War, there were the Carnatic Wars, and various other wars which were fought by the British, wherein all the Indian rulers were almost defeated, and the government of the East India Company started ruling our country. Now then began an era of oppression, suppression, atrocities, exploitation, plunder, and the drain of our country, which in turn led to the First War of Indian Independence, which is more popularly referred to as the Revolt of 1857. There were very many causes which led to the revolt, and they have been classified into political, social, economic, military, and religious causes. The unkind and oppressive rule, the very oppressive doctrine of lapses, as was introduced by Lord Dalhousie, and constant interference into the social, religious, and private life of the people agitated them, and the anger expressed in the form of the outbreak of 1857, the immediate cause being the introduction of the Enfield rifle, wherein the bullets that were used in this new rifle were required to be bitten by the mouth, and there was a rumor that the bullets were laced with the fat of the cow and the pig. And as we know that the cow is a sacred animal amongst the Hindus, while pig is a forbidden animal amongst the Muslim. So there was a lot of unrest and disaffection, and it got expressed in the form of a rebellion, an uprising, or a mutiny, and we prefer to call it the first war of Indian independence. Though the Indians put up a brave fight across many kingdoms, but the entire country was not involved. Many of the rulers of different states and kingdoms kept away from this revolt, and finally, because of various reasons like the superiority of the British commanders and the lack of training of our Indian leaders, a lack of organization and disunity, all led to the failure of this revolt. And very soon the British government fell back with utmost ferocity. This was followed by the Queen's Proclamation of 1858, which led to the liquidation of the British East India Company, and India came directly under the British rule. The Queen was proclaimed to be the Empress of India. The change in the circumstances paved the way for India's freedom movement, wherein many brave men and women participated in the movement to demand the liberation of our country. There came in the establishment of the Indian National Congress, which was supposed to work as a safety valve between the government and the people of India. There was a moderate phase, there was the extremist phase, wherein the leaders of the various phases of the national movement put forward their demands for the freedom of India, as well as reforms in the administrative setup of our country. Now, the prospects of the Indian national movement changed with the appearance of Gandhiji on the stage or the political arena of our country. Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, as we know him, returned to India from South Africa, where he was practicing as a barrister. He came back in 1915 after having faced a lot of discrimination on the grounds of race in South Africa. He returned with a new ideology, and he projected himself into the various programs related to the demand of reforms in our country. And with the passage of time, he attained a position of supreme leadership in India. His South African experience contributed in a number of ways to the foundations of his ideology and methods like passive resistance, satyagraha, and ahimsa. His philosophy is said to be influenced by philosophers like Emerson and Tolstoy. His first appearance happened at the Champaran Andolan, which was a movement for the demands that were put forward by the indigo cultivators against the oppression of the indigo planters. Here he had the company of political legendaries like Rajendra Prasad and J.B. Kriplani. This was followed by the Khera Satyagraha in Gujarat, which was also a peasant satyagraha. Then came in the non-cooperation movement, which is one of the biggest movements led by Gandhiji. And when we talk about the non-cooperation movement, this is very important to understand the various causes and the background that led to the launch of such a mass movement. The first cause being the introduction of the Rowlatt Act by the government in the year 1919 in March. This act was passed by the Imperial Legislative Council against unanimous opposition of all non-official Indian members. Now, why was there so much of unrest regarding this act? See, this Rowlatt Act of 1919 is regarded to be the most unjust act introduced by the government, because the government, or the police you can say, got many powers, including the ability to arrest the people and keep them in prison without a trial. That means this paved the way for detention without a trial, which automatically meant restriction on the civil rights of the people. And this detention could go up to a maximum of 2 years for minor acts. This in turn directly affected active politicians, gave more powers to the police, which was known for its notoriety and oppression. The act was resented by all sections of the Indian society, and Gandhiji gave the clarion call of satyagraha. Now, another cause which forced Gandhiji to launch the non-cooperation movement was the Jallianwala Bagh massacre, most infamous massacre that took place in the annals of Indian history. The British always feared the remarkable Hindu-Muslim amity and unity that existed in our country. In opposition to the Rowlatt Act, Hartals were organized, and most importantly, the Hartals of 30th March and 6th April at Amritsar, which were peaceful but massive affairs. The local leaders of Amritsar, Saifuddin Kichlu and Professor Satyapal, got arrested and they were deported. So a mass protest was organized at the Jallianwala Bagh in Amritsar in a very peaceful manner on the 13th of April, which was a day of Baisakhi. The crowd was unarmed. It had got together in a peaceful assembly to express the disaffection against these arrests and also the against the orders which were issued restraining Gandhiji from entering Delhi and Punjab. In a way, martial law had been clamped down on the town of Amritsar. Now, taking advantage of this opportunity, General Dyer, without a slightest warning to the unarmed crowd, which consisted of men, women and children, started firing over the people who were sitting there peacefully in an enclosed ground at Jallianwala Bagh. Now, the people started running here and there. There was no warning given to them. At least 379 people are reported to have been killed, but unofficially it could have been a much larger number. So this is one of the most most serious of crimes that was committed by the British government and the police in the history of India. Now, another cause which contributed for the launch of the non-cooperation movement was the Khilafat movement. Now, this movement was gaining rapid momentum in the year 1919 and 1920. Post-World War I, the Treaty of Sevres was signed with Turkey by the victor countries, and it proposed the abolition of the office of the Caliph, who happens to be the leader of the Muslims all across the world. So, in India, the Pan-Islamic movement against this was organized by the Ali brothers, who wanted to restore the Caliph of the Ottoman Empire. Now, here, Gandhiji decided to lend his support to the Khilafat movement and the Khilafat leaders in India. And together with the Khilafat movement, he decided to launch the non-cooperation movement as well in four stages, including the boycott of titles, civil services, police and army, against the three wrongs that were done, that is the Rowlatt Act, the Punjab massacre and the Khilafat wrong. Now, students left government and schools, left the government schools and colleges, lawyers gave up their practice, Swadeshi was the clarion call, even Guru Rabindranath Tagore surrendered his knighthood. The movement became massive, involving all sections of the Indian society, and it happened to be one of the largest organized mass movements that was organized in our country. Now, Gandhiji's main idea underlying the non-cooperation movement was that it was supposed to be a peaceful movement without the use of violence, based on his ideals and principles of satyagraha and ahimsa. However, unfortunately, what happened was that at a small kasba called Chauri Chaura, on the 4th of February 1922, there occurred a very violent incident which led Gandhiji to abruptly call off the non-cooperation movement. And now we are talking about the topic of the day, that is the Chauri Chaura incident, which happened around 100 years ago at a place called Chauri Chaura in the district Gorakhpur, Uttar Pradesh. Now, Chauri Chaura is the name of a small kasba in Gorakhpur, in the state of Uttar Pradesh. It is made up of two small villages, Chauri and Chaura. Chauri was the smaller of the two villages, while the Chaura was a little bigger than Chauri. and it the name owes its existence to the railways. The traffic manager named the rail station after these two adjacent villages as Chori Chora. Now, under the non-cooperation program of Gandhiji, it was decided that the participants who were the protesters were going to stick to non-violence and ahimsa and carry on the picketing of shops selling liquor, meat, fish and foreign products, especially the foreign made clothing, that is the cloth, were to be boycotted, and there was to be a picketing. In Hindi we use the word dharna for picketing. So to allege their participation, even some pledge forms were filled, and it was decided that people will move in crowds in a very peaceful manner. Even in Chori Chora, this was undertaken, and they will move through the bazaar and spread vigilance about boycotting of foreign products. Now, in one of these protest march, a formidable clash took place between the police and the commoners. During one of these, one Bhagwan Ahir, who was a local leader, was thrashed by the police, and he happened to be a demobilized soldier from the Mesopotamian campaign. Now, to protest against this, a crowd took out a march, and it crossed the lanes and by lanes and reached the Chori Chora bazaar. The police here, or the thana as we can say, was already prepared, because the police was expecting that the crowd would be expressing their disaffection for the beating up of Bhagwan Ahir. And Gupteshwar Singh, the thanedar, was expecting the crowd. So additional policemen were already there from Gorakhpur, including armed guards, to dissuade the crowd from marching onto the bazaar. The crowd passed the bazaar unhindered with derisory claps, and the police in retaliation fired in the air. However, this signal given in by the police was disregarded by the crowd. Instead, they responded by rushing and brick batting at the police. Now, this was a way too much. So the police fired back, and three of the crowd were shot dead. There suddenly started appearing a hail of stones on the police station by the furious peasants who was just standing across the railway line. The police, out of fear, retreated into the thana. The crowd locked the police officers, who were around 23 in number, inside the thana, set fire to the building by sprinkling it with kerosene oil seized from the bazaar. 23 policemen, including the station officer, were battered and burnt to death. The crowd dispersed by nightfall. As it is understood, and as it can be already be understood, that the repression was immediate. The pledge forms that were signed earlier by the crowd became a documentary proof of being a volunteer in the so-called riot. The list was compiled by the police, and the peasants found themselves in the dock as the Chori Chora accused. Gandhiji proposed a general suspension of the mass civil non-cooperation movement, which was finally suspended on 12th of February 1922. The case against the accused who had participated in the Chori Chora violence was taken up by the Sessions Court. Judgment came up on the 9th of January 1923. H.E. Holmes, the judge, acquitted 50 accused, and 172 were sentenced to death. This case was later on appealed in the High Court. The sentence was confirmed. 38 were acquitted and 110 were charged to life and other sentences. So this was a bit of detail about the Chori Chora incident, which acquires a very important place in the history of the Indian national movement, because it was the peaceful Asahyog Andolan that was launched by Gandhiji, suddenly being withdrawn due to the eruption of violence at Chori Chora. This year, the government of our country has decided to observe 100 years of the Chori Chora episode, under which various programs are being organized. So we need to definitely know about the history of this important episode. Thank you so much.